I'd like to welcome everyone to the February 16th meeting of the Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts. I think everyone that is going to be here tonight is here. We're a little bit short-staffed without Doug, Mary, or John, but we do have a quorum, so away we go. The first thing we're going to look to do here is to simply review and accept the previous meeting minutes. I handed out a handful of copies, and I know the meeting minutes aren't usually the most exciting, but one thing I would point out is to make sure everybody take a look at the section at the end. I think we had a pretty instructive conversation that, when distilled down, made some good points. So hopefully that's helpful if and when we pick that issue back up. So were there any comments or questions on those?
No, I have none. Do you have any?
Okay. I'd entertain a motion to pass the meeting minutes.
I will move the minutes as presented.
And seconded.
All right. All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay. So there's that. So we have a few things to go over tonight. The first of which is going to be the Senior Center expense budget.
Yes.
And here to present it, we have Marlene. I'm sorry, I don't know your last
Johnson.
Name. Johnson.
Yep.
And do you know all of us, or should we?
Nope.
Okay, maybe we could introduce ourselves if you want to start.
Ralph Healy.
Bill Cummings.
Okay.
Dylan Corpita,
yeah,
we spoke today.
Yeah.
Jeff Upton.
Yeah.
Skip Olmstead.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and there may be a couple things on here, as Marlene and I talked about, that we may need to follow up with on Doug, but I think we can at least walk through the majority of this. And please make sure, using the new packet that we handed out, I believe this has changed from the last one that we got.
Okay.
And so that budget is in the 500 section, 541. Be precise.
541-5420.
Yep.
This is in the order.
It is in the order that it appears on the budget in the beginning. It's roughly halfway through the stack. Yeah, the account number is 541-5420. It's in that order.
20 is about halfway through.
Everybody find it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I guess, Marlene, if you just kind of want to start, I know you're relatively new to the Senior Center, and kind of give us an overview of where things are and how you approach this budget and any particular areas you'd want to point out. And then I'm sure we may have some questions on top of that, but we'll go from there.
Oh, sure. Well, I'm fairly new. I've just been at the Senior Center since November of last year. And it's quite an active place that serves the three towns. Doing the budget, I went over all our expenses for maintenance, operating of the facility, and going through some of the bills. There were some things that was scheduled the last budget. We were really not spending that much. So what I did is I went from month to month and totaled how much we were actually spending and put that amount down for the next fiscal year. And then anything that was left over, I added it to our program expenses, which would have been the staff mileage, equipment, and miscellaneous programs cost, which would be entertainment, special programs if we wanted any. So that's pretty much, the change that was made. The other change was the director's salary, which was communicated when I had the job offer in November, that yes, I would take the position, but there would have to be a salary increase. It was prorated, and the prorating matched what it was, because you were already halfway through that fiscal year, or pretty much through it, and that this amount reflects the change. as well as my program assistant. I gave her a slight increase in her raise because she hasn't had one since 2016, and as you can see, it wasn't very much from there. And in our outreach person is our SIG grant that we receive.
So one quick bit of math just for you guys, because I spent a little time. So the outreach coordinator, $10,920.
Yeah.
Plus, if you go into operating, the SIG expenditures of $2,920. Those two line items equal, down in the grant section, the SIG grant of $13,840. So that SIG grant is funding those two line items. That grant, where this FY17 is the second of a three-year grant, so, and then you can reapply for it, so it could continue, but mm-hmm. that's just so, so we kind of put those pieces together.
Could you tell me what the active headcount of folks using the facility are?
Pardon, I'm sorry, I didn't hear you, sir.
How many seniors are utilizing the program in the space?
I would say my last count when I, at the end of the year, it probably from January of 2015 to November, we had roughly about 50 new clients who started at the senior center. And right now we probably average between 300 and 400, depending on the programs that are offered. Quite a few of our clients go to our special programs that we have, the Tai Chi, the osteo, the yoga programs that we offer. Other of them come to, like we're having a life safety, the life safety systems coming and for taxes. So it kind of mix and mingles, but the actual overall amount probably who sign up on a regular basis Monday, Wednesday, and Friday to the senior center is probably about 200, give or take.
And I'm ignorant of this. Is the facility just servicing Deerfield, or?
No, actually, we service Whately, Sunderland.
Oh, South County?
Yep,
so
South County.
Is this budget then, this is our percent of the budget?
Yes.
Well, you can, so down at the bottom, you can see the breakout under the total. So the total budget is 53,046. Deerfield's portion is 26,523.
I got it.
So when we go to vote, we'll be voting
yep.
our portion mm-hmm. of the budget.
So is that, does that change with headcount, or how do you weight that from year to year?
Actually, I'm not sure, because this is like my first budget. Mm-hmm. This, I just know that looking at all the other years in the past, it was divided pretty fairly with only like maybe a slight change every year. So
somebody set up in the past is what we're...
Yes, yeah. Yes. I mean, I'm not really too familiar. I just know mm-hmm. I did my annual report,
yeah.
and, you know, we had the 50 new seniors and stuff, so...
Let me throw something in. I don't know where the numbers came from, but they've been 50% Deerfield, 25% each for Whately and Sunderland for as long as I can remember, so... which isn't very far, but, you know, 4 or 5 years anyways.
So is there a steering committee or board or something? Who do you report to in theory?
The Board of Oversight.
Oh, that's okay. And
yep.
there are members from each of the towns?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Yep.
Do they actually meet?
They actually were meeting next week.
Okay.
Yes.
So, and we'll go back to, but away from the budget for a minute, as you're just kind of getting started, where do you see some opportunities to do some new and different things with the senior center, kind of away from budgets? Just, you know, is obviously there's some things we're doing well, and there's probably some things that you've seen in other places or that you'd like to kind of get us mm-hmm. to. Could you speak to any of examples of you know, new things you'd like to look into doing?
Yeah, sure. I would like to have a health fair. I think that would be very productive in our area, between Triad volunteers and the senior center, and a few of the hospitals, Franklin and Cooley Dick. That would be, you know, something I would want to do. What I'm trying to do is, there has been a request for the senior center to be open for 5 days a week, mm-hmm. but money is kind of tight, as we all know. So right now I'm in the process of trying to get programs, presentations, demonstrations, just different things that are out there, speakers, use some of our cultural grants from each of the towns.
I'd be happy to have a member of the Finance Committee go give a talk if anyone...
Oh, sure, that would be nice. And we could... So I wanted to open our center on Tuesdays and Thursdays, because my position is a 30-hour position, and I'm there Monday through Friday, which gives me that opportunity that I could open on a Tuesday for, actually, we do have one coming. It's My Life, My Health, and it is about managing chronic pain from Franklin County Home Care. And they're going to be there 6 weeks on a Tuesday. So that gives the seniors in the area, you know, a chance to come, where we, one, do not have to pay extra staff because I'm already there, mm-hmm. and we do not have to look for any other extra money, because some of that we can use from the other organizations, and we also can use it from our cultural, you know, grants that we receive as well.
You might check with the Y. They run an annual health fair for seniors, mm-hmm. and it's quite well organized, and they bring in all kinds of people from the hospital and community, and they set up in the gym, and they have stations.
Yeah, I've worked at... my background's in long-term care.
Okay.
So as an activity director and a nursing home administrator, I've had a lot of experience doing health fairs and bringing other communities and other organizations in, Avada Hearing and, you know, just a blood pressure clinic and, you know, stuff of that nature. And Lisa, our town nurse, is more than welcome, you know. She's going to be helping us.
No, I was thinking it's free. All you have to do is get your people up
there.
Oh,
yeah, it is. And it's good for them because, you know, that's a, you know, great way to advertise and not have to pay for it and get more, you know, different clients.
Okay.
You mentioned a couple hundred people on average over 3 days. So,
well, between also the Thursday as well. Sorry, okay. Because that was the special program, the Tai Chi, yeah.
So if we divided that up by the days, on average, how many people are there on a given day?
Fridays are our best days. I would say about 30 on Fridays, because mm-hmm. There is yoga in the osteo class. Mm-hmm. Happening over next door at the church, and then we have another exercise class on Thursday, which probably is roughly about 10, mm-hmm. and Wednesdays, Mondays it's kind of a slow day, but we're also finding when we do have special programs like on Tuesday or Thursday, we get about 30, you know, other people mm-hmm. from different areas. And
so a number might be from 10 to 30 on average.
Yeah, about 10 to 30. Mm-hmm. Friday being, and Wednesday and Fridays being the very, you know, very good days, I guess you want to call it. Yes.
Quite a few years ago, I stopped in there for something, and they seem to be serving a meal. Do they have meals there? Or?
Yes, we do. Yeah, from Franklin County Home Care.
Every day, or I mean, that you're open?
It is every day for the Meals on Wheels for mm-hmm. the afternoon program, but we also have it for ourselves on Monday, Wednesdays, and mm-hmm. Fridays.
But that's a function of them?
Yes, a function of them, right.
Your budget?
Well, there is a donation mm-hmm. that, you know, it's appreciated.
Okay.
And that mm-hmm. goes well to it, you know. Mm-hmm.
Now do senior centers in various areas try to do something like look at the demographics of the towns they're covering and how many people are going and say, okay, this is roughly the percentage of seniors that typically go to senior centers, or were above average or below, like, is there, I don't know if people do that. Is there a way to try to identify, like, you know, what percent of the senior population is going in here versus other towns in the area?
Yes,
to theirs?
Through our census, yeah. As soon as our census all come back and they get, you know, counted and everything, then I will take them. Yeah. And this will be my first year actually doing it because I started in November.
Sure.
You know, so I will have to go back and see, mm-hmm. you know, the other, you know, my predecessor, what she put down. And then when I do my next annual report, I can add those into it, you know, and just instead of just adding who joined from January 2015 until November.
And putting money aside, what is your biggest issue?
I'm trying to manage the space that we have. How to have programs going on based with the limited space. That we have.
Appropriate space for what you're doing.
Yes, appropriate space. And, I mean, you can look at it and say, yes, we could have a bigger, you know, senior center. But I look at it is that if we cannot manage programs based on a small area, we're still going to run into problems.
Conflicts.
Conflicts. Because mm-hmm. as a director of activities, mm-hmm. I know that if I have someone who wants to come to bingo or who wants to come to a special program and exercise group at 10:30 and they don't get up until 10, they're going to miss that. So I need to plan, you know, we need to plan better. So I think that's one of my goals is, and that's why opening the center with special programs on Tuesdays and Thursdays to catch that residue of others. Yeah, mm-hmm. to have other options.
Right. Yep.
You know, until we find another place or until one yeah. place comes along.
Do you, your snow removal and landscaping, which is mowing, I guess, do you contract that out or?
As far as I know, it's from Bill's Landscaping and our landscaping. I don't know. I just know that it has always,
it
has been here. And I looked at how much we do actually spend,
yeah.
and I did take it down a little because I think we were putting more in the budget than it really needed to be. It could have, it went into, it was more useful in other programs for us.
Mm-hmm. It is interesting.
Yeah. The town kids, building. When they're doing mm-hmm. cemeteries
so,
and things.
It's not like it's you mentioned, so you're there every day during the week.
Yes.
And then the program assistant, I'm sorry, what is their name? I'm just trying to get to know who everybody is.
Sue,
okay.
Yep.
And is, what? How does she, or how do you generally split up her hours every day or just certain days?
She has normally been 15 hours a week, the 3 days, 5 hours.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. So that's Monday, Wednesday, Friday.
Yep, Monday, Wednesdays, gotcha. And Fridays, yep.
And then the outreach coordinator?
She is going to be, as it says, down here, 15 hours per week for 52 weeks.
And same days, Monday, Wednesday, Friday again, or is that
going to? Actually, that is going to be a little more flexible because there are going to be times where they have to go outreach and,
uh-huh.
you know, reach.
Might be more event
specific. The other seniors, yes. Yeah. So it's going to be a little more flexible on time.
Okay, and who's that? The outreach coordinator?
Actually, right now I am the outreach coordinator, just filling in until we find someone.
Okay. Okay, so then I guess so then between the two, then you are down for 40 hours a week then?
Actually, it's I do my 30 hours and I just squeeze it in and try to muddle it through the best, you know, to the ability. We haven't had one since, you know, June. So
okay.
We are working into trying to get one when I will be meeting with them next week to discuss, you know, that position.
Do you know who pursued the grants that you have?
As far as I know, my predecessor, Diana, did. She did the SIG grant, the formula grant. Right now, Sue, between the directors, Sue did our cultural grant. And then I guess when they were due again, Mark Pruhensky did the formula and stuff again, because it kind of ended. It needed to be completed when Diana left. So I will do them moving forward.
What does SIG mean? SIG.
Oh, wait. I wrote it down somewhere. I don't think I wrote it down on here.
The service incentive
service
grant.
Service incentive grant. That's right.
And says formula. What is formula grant?
The formula grant is my position.
But where does that come from? Where does the grant money come from? We got $18,000 in formula grants. Do you know where that comes from, or?
No, I'm not really sure.
Okay, and the service incentive grant, that's from, you don't know.
That's from the state.
That's a state, and then the one above it, the state. Title III, is a Franklin County specific thing. Doug may know more about the formula grant.
Yes.
Source.
Yep.
Out of curiosity, who filled out the sheet here? I assume you didn't fill this out entirely by yourself. Who helped you with it, I guess? And the one that I'm looking at is the employee benefit life insurance, just employee benefits retirement.
Well, from the past, I figured the salary and the program assistant and the outreach coordinator. The outreach and coordinator and the program assistant, I figured out for the program assistant to give her a raise from the 2016 to 2017. The outreach coordinator was already done based on the grant that we applied for, the SIG grant. When you applied for 3 years, for the 3 years, you had to give amount of how much the outreach coordinator will work, how much she will make.
Both of these people, the program assistant and the outreach coordinator, work 15 hours a week?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
So, Skip, I would think that'd be that line item you're looking at, both the retirement increasing, and then also if you look at the group insurance going from 12,000 to zero, are two questions I have that I don't know that Marlene would have the answer to, because I think those are more things made at the town level.
Yeah, and that would be like the formula grant. I'm not really absolutely sure on that. I didn't take care of that. That was Mark Pruhensky who took care of that.
I believe the number is something like 18% on the, I'm not exactly sure what the number is on the retirement.
So,
but two people don't get retirement.
Right. Yeah. I see what you're saying. Yes.
Well, I guess I question if they're 15-hour employees.
They don't get retirement.
Right.
Yeah. It's unclear, though, if they simply doubled it, because I would think the assessment went up on a per-person basis for retirement. I don't know that, but I think so, and it less than doubled. So I don't know what's going on there, but we'd certainly need to.
Well, it seems to me it was something like 14% last year, 14% of the $28,000, and then 18% or 19% of the 32, or whatever the number should be.
To the extent that Marlene is also the outreach coordinator, maybe that goes into the calculation as well. I don't know.
Well, what I was going to do is just ask Doug to check it.
Yeah. Are you talking about the retirement, sir?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Okay. When I did it before this just recently got changed, it was $6,198. So that was my retirement as a full-time employee of South Deerfield.
Right, okay.
I did not have, it does not have to do anything with the program or the outreach coordinator position.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, that's fine. I'm just going to have Doug recheck that one there.
Okay.
And then the administrative overhead line item, do you know kind of what that points to, goes to? It's the last one in that top salaries section. It says C calculations.
Yeah. That's it, where it says C calculations. So, and I don't imagine, I'm guessing you don't have that information. That's why I didn't ask them. So I was going to ask Doug to check that one out too. Mm-hmm. And to make whatever adjustments are.
All right, well, given that I do think we're going to have a couple of outstanding items, but does anyone have any more questions that you know, have to do with what's going on at the Senior Center, plans going forward, other sections of this budget that Marlene would have more direct control over than, you know, things like the retirement assessment?
Mm-hmm. No, I don't have any questions.
I'm all set.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm good with it, too.
Okay. Well, I don't think we're going to vote the budget tonight just because we have these outstanding things that are really kind of away from,
right.
from your operational
things. I mean, I wish I could
things.
Help you, but I really,
no,
we
understand that.
Just the other parts.
You know, both you're new and also some of this stuff really kind of is reaches
Doug's,
across the
yes.
entire town, so it's not specific mm-hmm. to your department. So thank you very much for coming in. I'll probably be back in touch if we have any follow-up questions or mm-hmm. just to share what we do learn from Doug and make sure we're all on the same page. So.
Oh, that would be great. Thank you.
Good.
All right. Nice.
Thank you.
And then we went through the other fund stuff, so the special revenue funds on the phone.
Right,
so
yeah, on the phone when we did that.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, perfect.
All right, great. Thank you. It was nice meeting you, gentlemen.
Yep. Same here.
Thank you for
nice
coming.
Yep.
Meeting you, too.
Drive safely.
I will.
Come on down.
So,
you're the next.
See if the budget is right. That's right. The price is right.
Yeah. So when do we expect to see your mom and dad back?
Two more weeks.
They said that they would be definitely back by March 1st to be able to vote. But I think you'll be able to see him on the Saturday before. What is it? February 27th or. Yeah, right around there. They're, depending on whether they may leave Wednesday or Thursday, or they may
drive
Friday, Saturday. So that's when you'll see them.
So did he say March 1st of which year?
This year. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I think Saturday the 27th, Skip, they'll be back. Yeah.
So that's when the babysitters come back?
Exactly. My mother-in-law's at the house right now. Yeah.
What's that?
My mother-in-law's at the house right now.
At your house?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, with kids.
It's nice you give them the opportunity to bond.
Oh, yeah.
Is that what I do?
Yeah. Yeah.
Try to make you feel good, you know.
Yeah, they don't bother me. I enjoy the whole family.
So you should thank us for getting you out here tonight.
Exactly.
I did find.
All right, so in the most recent version that we got, it looks like it's broken into four sections. We got mm-hmm. police payroll, police department benefits,
numbers,
police department expense,
series.
And police department capital. So whichever order you'd like to go.
I'm missing two of them.
So 210, 51.
Backs of the pages?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
There you go.
Yeah, I'm glad you guys have the benefits because I don't.
Okay.
Would you like a copy?
Sure.
Payroll, expense, capital. There you go. Fronts and backs. That one's just going to be cannibalized.
So any preference in which way you guys want to go? You guys have canine control in your packet?
We do, and if that's one you can address, then that would be great also.
All right, so canine control, let's start there.
Okay, hang on, let me just find that one.
Sure.
That is just after the ones we were looking at, so just a couple more pages back. After the inspection stuff. The canine control, we get a number of 15398.
So it's number of canine control.
It's 292-5400.
292-5400. It's about four back, yeah. Just before that, there you go.
Everybody got it?
Yeah.
All right, good. So canine control is a regional partnership. We share an actual animal control officer with the town of Greenfield and Montague. Deerfield pays 25%, Montague pays 25%, Greenfield pays 50%. The guy that's actually designated for this position, Colin, with the town of Greenfield, is a benefited employee. He is also in one of the unions. So as part of their union contract, he got a two-year step increase over 16 into 17. So you see an increase in the budget of $888. Our portion, the 25% of his salary and benefits, is the $15,398. So he is available to us on call 24 hours a day. He deals with everything under the sun, loose or raccoons hiding underneath porches. He'll crawl right under a porch where a uniformed cop with a gun belt just can't get. So he's a very good resource for us.
Okay.
Is that because he doesn't wear a gun? Or just because he's...
No, he does wear a gun, yeah.
Yep. He's just willing to go.
When you come in at BDUs and all you have on it is a gun, and anybody that knows Colin knows he's possessed. I mean, he'll never tell you no. You know, boa constrictor? Fine. I mean, he's where the rest of us are running.
Just out of curiosity, what union is he in?
I don't know which one it is, which collective bargaining group it is.
Who does he work for up there?
He was working for the police department as their buildings maintenance guy, but he had taken this course on his own initiative to be certified by the state as an animal control officer. And it's like an 80-hour training. So, you know, if we were going to start sending cops to it, it would be an ungodly accomplishment to really take on. You know, this partnership came up, the law changed, you had to have an animal control officer assigned per town, you know, and I really didn't want to go to the 80-hour training and then get called out at 3 o'clock in the morning for skunks and raccoons and bats, and then there's kids involved, and now you have to take that animal, you have to decapitate it, you have to mail the head out to be analyzed for rabies, because otherwise you have an infant being vaccinated with stuff you don't want to put in them if they're not positive. I mean, it's an animal in of itself, and he does a phenomenal job. Yep.
So we're not to question this then.
You can question anything you want. That's
and so when
that's your job.
When he signed his contract to get the step, now is that flat there for some number of years, stepping from there for some number of years? Do we know what the further steps look like?
Yeah, we have a projected budget, and I don't remember what the numbers are. I would have to flip through my book, but it's nothing excessive. I think they're 2-2.5% over the years.
Okay.
I don't see a line in here. Where are the costs of the facility?
He actually is housed out of the town of Greenfield. The facility that we bring animals to is a regional partnership. It's up in Montague, and it's done by the sheriff's department. So there's no cost.
Oh, isn't that nice?
Yeah, there's no cost.
Okay, they absorb that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep, the program works very well. Mm-hmm. Our guys will bring dogs there off duty. We don't call them in unless we have to.
Yep.
If we get a barking dog, we handle it. If we get a loose dog, we handle it. If we get something that's more dramatic and severe, we will call him in.
Mm-hmm.
And his agreement with the town of Greenfield, Deerfield, and Montague is he doesn't charge us overtime. He just takes comp time immediately that following week.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
So he'll come in late or he'll leave early and kind of flex his hour. So,
okay.
Yeah, he's been great.
Okay.
So if we go to police department expenses.
Well, actually, would you guys like to vote canine control?
Yeah.
Sure. Is there any other questions? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I'd entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion.
$15,398. Second. Mm-hmm. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Mm-hmm. All right. Unanimous.
All right. Police department expense.
Can we do capital next?
Absolutely. Whatever you would like, sir.
The only reason they ask is that
I'm pretty easy. Capital, we, every year, I think everybody's aware of this, I dealt with this with the Capital Improvement Committee last year. Ever since 2002, we've been getting a cruiser on an annual basis. And what we found is that when we add the mileage up for the shifts, 24 hours a day, two guys on a day, we figured that we were burning through about 148,000 miles a year on average, which equates out to about one car. Mm-hmm. So it's hit or miss. It depends on how many new kids I have. It depends how many senior guys I have, whether we've had weather events, whether we put on third or fourth patrols, because we have road races and on and on. Most are aware that Deerfield's a busy town. We're a hub community for Conway, Whately, and Sunderland, so we do have a lot of events here. So there's specialized patrols that are put on, and we are still burning through a car a year. The oldest car in the fleet right now is a 2011 Crown Vic. It's the last remaining Crown Vic. Right now, before replacement, it's at 134,879 miles. 134,879. And even if town meeting approves a car in April, by the time you order that car and get it in, you're looking at October and November. Mm-hmm. So if we take that October, November projection, this car will have 160,000, 165,000 miles on it. So it served the town well.
Now, what is the total number of cars?
We have six cars. We have five marked cars, mm-hmm. and we have one unmarked cruiser. So we have six vehicles. And I've stuck to my vehicle replacement plan that I went over with the Finance Committee and Capital and the Board of Selectmen. Basically, what happens is every single year we replace a marked car. So every 5 years, they're turned over. Okay. Every 10 years, we put in for an additional car, and that's the unmarked cruiser that I drive. Okay. So that's a 10-year vehicle. And in 10 years, I'll be 2 to 3 years out from retirement. Maybe I'll make it last longer, or maybe in 7 or 8 years, it'll start to be a problem child. I don't know. Mm-hmm. My goal is to get 10 out of it and figure out where we're at.
And that was purchased or replaced when? When did that
That was purchased
start?
In 2013.
Okay.
And that replaced a 2004 Ford Explorer. So to rewind the clock a little bit, Yankee Candle donated a car to us. Most remember that in December of 91. That car lasted until December of 2003, in which a 2004 was purchased to replace it because it was rotting out. It was just, it was done. It had passed its life expectancy mm-hmm. with us. Served the town well. We had 3 years of community policing built up on the books. Deerfield used to get $38,000 a year in community policing grants. So Chief Waz, being very frugal, he's very, very good with money, very in touch with his budget, had 3 years of grants that he had pockets of money that were there. And they basically told him, if you don't burn down some of that money, we're not going to give you this next year grant. So he, in turn, replaced that old vehicle and purchased that Ford Explorer. So this is the first time back in 2013 the town has really replaced it with town meeting funds.
Okay. And so you feel good about, you know, your second oldest Crown Vic won't be replaced for a couple of years. You feel good about where that one is right now with that Horizon?
All of our other four marked cars are the new police utilities.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So you have a five marked cars. You have one older Crown Vic.
Yeah.
And then you have four of the utilities, which are phenomenal. The Crown Vics, anybody that knows them or driven them, in New England, in snow, they're horrible. They're fun. You do your donuts all night long, fly through Frontier, and have a good time. Horrible responding to calls. You get a call up near your father's house. I know we're recorded. I don't mind. People enjoy a little humor. So you get a call up near your father's house, Dylan, getting up that hill in a Crown Vic. Good luck.
Yeah.
These new utilities with the all-wheel drive and snow tires on them, phenomenal.
They'll be happy to hear that.
Yeah, night and day. Yeah, you actually can get to a call. Yeah. If you have a foot of snow, it's no big deal anymore.
So, just a question. When you buy a new vehicle, you take it back to the dealer while it's under warranty?
Absolutely. The first 36,000 miles are under warranty. However, depending on the way the state bid is that year, some of those vehicles will come through with powertrain warranties to 75 or 100,000 miles. So every time we take in a new car, you see my three-ring binder here, mm-hmm. we have a three-ring binder on every single car. That includes the title, it includes the window decal, it includes a state bid that year. So when we flip through and go, oh God, we just burnt through a transmission, we're gonna go through that book and say, that bid year was 100,000 mile warranty. That car's going to Northampton Ford. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So are you getting to the, do you get to the point where you bring them down to the mechanic at the highway garage, or?
We use Chuck at the highway garage all the time.
Okay.
He does all of our routine repair. He does oil changes. He does brake jobs.
Okay.
He will even dive into major repairs on the cars as long as they're not under warranty.
Yep.
Yeah, we're not going to pay for parts and pay Chuck's hourly rate when
right.
I can just drive it to Northampton and have it fixed for free. Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah, I mean, he's done a phenomenal job.
Okay.
So two things.
Ask away.
The Crown Vic
mm-hmm.
passed precedent staying as they are.
Mm-hmm.
I assume you're going to trade it in.
I'm going to what?
You're going to trade it in.
Generally, what we do is we put them out to bid.
Okay.
And when we put them out to bid, we've been finding that the town gets about $2,000
mm-hmm.
for them. So we put one out to bid last year, and I think you guys remember this.
Mm-hmm.
We stuck one of them out to bid, and it came back at $450. And I talked to the selectman. I said, listen, $450, let's stick it at the new highway garage. We'll hold on to it for a year or two for scrap parts for this other Crown Vic. And we'll rebid it out when we send this other Crown Vic down the road.
Okay.
You know,
yeah.
So it's still sitting at the old highway or the new highway garage if you drive over there.
My point was, and I mentioned this to you last year, so I'll go back and do the same thing again. I think it makes sense to stick one down there, and I would like to see you make keep the vehicle, not put miles on it, but
mm-hmm.
when you need to go out on a detail and you're parked on the highway, or one of your officers are, to use that rather than use one of the $42,000 new vehicles.
Yeah, generally we do. I mean, anybody that audits what I've done with Crown Vicks knows that I've been turning those cars in with 180 to 190,000 miles. I'm
barely
slightly frugal, so I burn those things right till the end, till the, you know, the rear end's going in them, the transmission's starting to slip, and I'm just not putting any more money into the brakes and the tires. I'll even swap out onto a different one if they're newer tires. So I totally agree with you. On a side note, when people see those cruisers on a detail, it's in, I've covered this with finance before, I've covered it with the Capital Improvement Committee, as well as the Board of Selectmen. We charge an hourly rate for those cars to be there. On average, in a normal detail year, we collect about $11,000 in fees between administrative fees and cruiser
mm-hmm.
fees. You combine those numbers, our average is $11,000 a year. So that kind of offsets the insurance and the operating costs and the gas and
Yep.
So if people see those cars out there for the safety of the detail crew, there's a method to the madness.
John, we went through all of this a few years ago, and I think that plan sounded good then, and it seems to be holding that it is about one car a year that you're burning up. And it just seems so practical to get out of this thinking of just capital planning versus just a more of a replacement type of thing, because it's like a used item. You're wearing them out, and you know you're going to need another. When we try to stretch it out too far, you just wind up in the mess that you were in a while ago there, where everything was pretty tough shape. So you feel as though
the number is working phenomenal. We really, other than replacing the Explorer with the Tahoe, we haven't done anything different. Mike Waz, the last 9 years as chief of police, was getting a car every single year. The only thing I've done is hold those cars over longer. What does it cost you a year? A couple oil changes, maybe brakes or tires here or there. And insurance-wise, it costs us $641 per car.
Mm-hmm.
So if we hold an old car over for 6 months, you're looking at $300 to $400 of insurance, maybe an oil change, $40 for Chuck to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So with what you're offsetting it, you take it to court, you take it to training, you take it on a detail. To me, it's a home run. Burn the car into the ground.
Mm-hmm.
That's less miles on the new fleet.
One would be interested to go back and take an average cost of maintaining the vehicles when they weren't on a regular basis replaced.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how that, it's not worth the time to go through it. But The thing that crosses my mind, though, is at least now you're dealing with good vehicles that are much safer and they're reliable, and there's some kind of a qualitative measurement to that as well.
Yeah. Well, the tough part with vehicles, and we've all seen this in our own personal cars, is you can take two exact same vehicles, same model year, everything. One can be a lemon, and the other can be phenomenal. I had a car last year that had near 190,000 miles on it. My guys liked it better than this one that had 115 last year. Mm-hmm. They wanted to swap them and keep the other one. I'm like, well, what is it? Is it the seat? We'll just swap the driver's seat out. No. It's the car in total. You're telling me a 190,000-mile car drives better, you like it more, than a car with 115. Yeah, no, and consensus of the agency. This wasn't like one person. But what do you do? Mm-hmm. You know, when you're the administrator, 115 or 190?
If it was 115 and 130, I'd say, well, you want it, we'll keep them. But 190, it's one of those things where you...
Yeah. It is what it is. Yep.
So the last question I had.
Ask away.
$42,500.
Yes.
And the, I guess, requested amount is $66,938.
All right.
What's the difference between those? What's the other
if you go down,
$24,000?
Go down bottom to the notation where it says, I was unable to put in a new line item for the town and police department defibrillator replacement. Should be a line in 2017 for $22,500. So what I did is I ultimately filled out Capital Improvement Committee replacement paperwork to replace all the defibrillators in the town. They're all basically 8 to 12 years old. They have a life expectancy of 8 to 10 years. And I refuse to just do the police department. I would rather, if I'm going to do it, just wipe the slate clean. I know everything's new. I know all the pad expiration dates. I can have one of my guys start to track them, because you have a defibrillator right back there that the expiration on the pads is 2012. So to me,
so
I looked at it.
How many is that?
10. I think it's 11.
Okay.
Yep. Yep. So we looked at library, senior center, town hall, even the new highway garage. Berniston, a guy had a heart attack in the highway garage. Police department, and then cruiser.
The original ones went in on a grant, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked around in circles over this, because it wasn't quite, it was unanimous eventually, but it took a number of nights. And these are compatible with the equipment on the ambulance, so the pads don't have to come off. Mm-hmm. They stay right there and they plug into them.
And you can't kill yourself with them, I understand. Your hands have to be in the right spot when you push the button.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, it gives you several warnings to stand clear. Yeah. If your part of your body's still touching them,
you're going to get it.
So the question,
call that a wake-up call.
The question we had that I don't think really got answers was, are they inspected by anybody on a periodic basis?
No.
Do you want to take that on?
That's why I'm doing it.
Okay.
So is this?
I have serious concerns that, you know, we have pads that are expired.
Mm-hmm.
And the pads are not cheap. They're, you know, $60 a pair. Now you get a pediatric set in there and an adult set in there. $120 to replace pads every 3 years. That's why I'd just rather wipe the slate clean, assign one of my cops to start tracking it, walk through the library, the senior center, the highway garage as a monthly duty, and sign off.
Do the schools have them?
I'm sure the elementary school has them. I'm sure the high school does. I'm positive. Yeah. Where they are, I don't know. But I guarantee
school
nurse they
have them someplace, probably.
Yeah, I didn't spearhead the schools as well. I figured I would do town buildings and police department. I figured that they would have their own capital for it.
And so the differential is whatever that exact number is. There's no other line items because it's kind of a weird non-even amount.
There's
right.
Yeah, it's $24,438. And my question is that in a capital budget someplace?
It is. It got voted.
Okay, so it's actually on a separate line item.
Yeah.
Okay. So we want to confirm that, because whatever we vote is probably the $42,500 that we're voting here for this budget.
I think that's probably correct.
Yep, you're right.
Okay. And John, one more question. So, you know, 42.5 is the amount you have for the vehicle. Like, where, I know it probably changes every year, but where has it kind of been coming in at in terms of how much it's actually costing?
Right around $42,000. We've been given back about $400 to $500.
Yeah,
we've been right at the 42 mark. Those cars went, I mean, I remember when Crown Vics were $16,000. And then literally the last year of a Crown Vic, it was at $24,800. Those new utilities are $28,000, $29,000. And then you start equipping them because we can't transfer the cage over, the center console with all the radios. None of the lights fit on that vehicle. So you have to re-outfit the fleet. The question is next year, when we finally get to be at a replacement point with that first utility we bought, can we salvage some of the equipment? Can we do a reduction? And that's something that I'm going to have to address next year. What's still good in that car? What's not? Can we take 10 grand worth of stuff and swap it into that car and reduce this 42.5 to 35? So, you know, as a heads up for next year, there is the possibility there. You know, some of the lights that are out, you always want to replace. If they're on the push bumper, you want to replace them. I mean, a new push bumper on the car because they rust after 4 to 5 years. So, for structural integrity. Yep, we'll see.
But it looks as though the vehicle is going to be pretty stable as far as the size and the configuration, I would think.
Yeah, absolutely.
It seems to be pretty well accepted now by all police, and I can't foresee major changes coming for quite some time.
They make two different versions. Well, first of all, you have the Dodge Charger. The Dodge Charger has been prone to a couple different issues, so a lot of departments steer away from them. The key problem I have with the Charger is visibility. The second problem with the Charger is it's too fast. You put new cops in it, it's a recipe for disaster. They're going too fast, and I start getting speeding complaints with my guys. I don't like it. And then I get a little ornery. So I like them going the speed limit or five under the speed limit. This is Deerfield. I want them out there, and I want them slow, and I want them visible. The Chevy released another Caprice Classic. Same thing. It's a rocket ship. It's like 390 horsepower. It's rear-wheel drive only.
Oh, that's...
So now you have... Dodge finally came out with a Charger that's all-wheel drive, but it's just too quick, and that visibility, if you ever sit in one, is just not there. So it leaves you with the Fords, and most departments migrated to the Fords over the year. They're 70 to 80% of the cruisers across the country. Well, Ford makes two versions. They make a sedan, and they make a utility. They are not Ford Explorers. They are built on a Ford Taurus chassis, and they are fully modified for police work, including the stability package. All the shocks are changed out, everything through to the struts, everything is heavy duty in them. The braking system is oversized, so if you go from a rapid start to a rapid halt, you can stop faster. The transmission cooler, you know, the oversized cooling system, everything about that car is made for policing, including the interior. When you get in that car, there's no armrests in it because we want cops to fit in there with gun belts on. We don't want them to have back problems and squeezing around. We want that mobility in the car. And everything's ergonomically designed for police work. That car was built by a committee that was selected by Michigan State Police of cops all across the country. And they designed that car, like I said, from a Ford Taurus chassis. So a lot of people, you'll hear people say, oh, the Explorers. It's not an Explorer. It's nothing even to do with an Explorer. It's not even on the same chassis.
The sedan.
Yes.
Have you looked at that as an alternative to the wagon?
We've looked at the sedan. I've spoken to two police departments that have them, and the consensus is that if you look at the cubic interior space in that vehicle, it's much smaller. So if you have small statured police officers, fine.
Even the front?
Even the front.
Okay.
Yep, even the front. So in Greenfield and in Montague, only the smaller police officers will drive it because the bigger guys, girls, whoever it may be,
complicates scheduling,
feel uncomfortable in the car. So if you really are looking for a full-duty vehicle that anybody can jump in and fly to a call, a major incident, or just patrol, you obviously want the bigger vehicle. And it's not that much bigger. The cost difference between the two is about $1,400 between the sedan and the utility. What's the gas mileage difference? 0.8 of a gallon.
Seems like the state police seem to have pretty much the
a utility.
They have zero cars. They're all utilities.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because of that size and the whole package that came along with it.
It seems like that storage space would be good in the back if you had to carry something.
Yep.
Or someone.
John, could you explain the number of vehicles works well for you now? Could you explain how that kind of runs as far as vehicles? I don't know if
Absolutely.
I'm being clear or not, but
Absolutely.
Just so... I think some people need to hear it, including myself.
No, absolutely. Yep. So, as I stated, we have one unmarked cruiser, and we have five marked cars.
Yep.
The unmarked cruiser, I take home every night. It's parked in my garage. I have been averaging, in the past 25 months that it's been in service, 1,000 miles a month. I'm at, like, 24,800. So, 12,000 miles a year. That's where I figured, you know, 10 years down the road, if I get 130,000, 140,000 miles on that car, you know, that's pretty decent. Mm-hmm. The five... marked cruisers are assigned to full-time officers. So the supervisors, the sergeants, have their own car. There's two sergeants, and there's a sergeant on every 3 to 11 of the week. Doesn't matter if it's a Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. One works two eve shifts and two day shifts. The other works four eve shifts. With the 4-2 rotating schedule, every night of the week, there's a supervisor on. So that car is driven by those two people for those eight patrol shifts a week. So we know over a five-year period, when we average their mileage, that that car is going to leave us with about 136,000 miles if I leave it with them. If I give it to new kids, you're going to see it average out to 160. So then I take every full-time guy I have and I assign them to a car. And that way, it creates consistency. It creates tracking. If a car's smashed up, I can track it back to a specific shift and say it was inspected on this shift. This is who assigned it on the next shift. And what happened? Mm-hmm. So the continuity and consistency is there. They know what car they're getting into. And you really get to know the vehicle you drive when you really handle a vehicle at high speeds. Mm-hmm. And you know if your car, the tires are getting low, you know if the brakes are starting to pulsate. Well, if you jump from car to car to car, you're less likely to report that. But if it's your car and you know a diminished capacity with it, you're going to make a notation to myself or the cruiser maintenance guy and say, hey, you know, would you have the brakes peaked out on my car? So every car is assigned to full-time people, and then the part-time guys automatically are assigned the two oldest cars in the fleet. Whatever the highest mileage cars are, because a good management concept, we know if we're going to get rid of those cars, where do I want to burn my mileage? Mm-hmm. Is a senior guy more likely to be involved in an accident or park the wrong way at an accident scene and get rear-ended, or a newer kid? Yeah. We know statistically it's more likely a newer kid. So there's a reason why I do what I do. With that said, there are exceptions. You take Bobby Warger, who's been around 33 years, or Joey Mechkoski, who's a sergeant for UMass Amherst, but Joey's been part-time for us for 27 years. I have them assigned to newer cars,
mm-hmm.
and rightfully so. They work 3-4 shifts a month. The mileage is nothing, you know, staggering high. So I assign them to newer cars because I know they're going to take care of them. I know they're not out there pounding on them. And just as a reward, because they've been here 27 and 33 years, yeah, you're assigned a newer car. So that's kind of how it works.
Yep.
What used to happen, we used to have three marked cars when I first took over. And Deerfield is a beautiful, more quiet town than most. I get that, but I'm also a realist.
Mm-hmm.
I had guys at court. I had detail companies that are yelling for cruisers that need cruisers there. I got two guys on patrol. Those two guys respond to a domestic. They're up arresting somebody. The next shift comes in, and there's a call pending or two calls pending. I don't even have a cruiser sitting out there. And that's a normal day in Deerfield. People think, oh, John, is that once a month? That is a normal day.
So the number of vehicles work well then for
Absolutely.
The department
yes.
and also for the town because of the mileage and being able to turn over. I know we need to purchase a new vehicle every year, but because of the safety and so on and so forth with miles, it keeps the vehicles in good shape and response and everything is there when need be.
Yes.
Okay.
A couple of questions for you.
Ask away.
On the budget that I've got here in front of me,
I have nothing in there for resource officer. There's no amount on mine. Is there in yours?
Which one are you at now?
Looking at?
Oh, you went
payroll.
Through the payroll.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry. Let's drop that for a minute.
We're still
go back
on,
to the capital. And,
okay. Still on capital.
We're still on capital.
Yeah, sorry. Any, all right, we'll get to that in a second.
So we got defibrillators and we got the cruiser.
Yeah. So I think the defibrillators are going to be handled through another part of the budget. So yep. Thank you for the information. And we can follow up if we have any more questions. I think for this budget for us tonight, it's just the cruiser at $42,500. Does anyone have any more questions?
Nope.
And would we like to vote some of these budgets tonight? Do we want to percolate on all of these budgets and vote them another time?
The 42,500, I don't have a problem with. I just want to see where the 24,438 is. That's all. So
yeah, we're not voting the bigger amount. We would just vote the
42,500. Right. So if everybody's comfortable with that, I'll move the 42,500.
I'll second that.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Nope, unanimous. Okay, John, would you like to do payroll benefits or expense?
Let's do payroll.
Okay.
So there's my question.
All right.
Or there's one of my questions.
All right, so that's a great question. Well, mine still has it in it. I don't know why it's been removed from yours. That's a discussion I'll have with the Board of Selectmen. I know there's several things in the works regarding it. However, starting from the top, all the officers were budgeted for a step increase. If somebody was at step 10, there's then a provision in place where the Selectmen vote a cost of living adjustment for above and beyond step 10. Mm-hmm. We're in a year that we're doing a benefits study, and I believe, you know, we just hired a company to do it. So we're interested to see what those results are. But ultimately, the police department is in a contract renegotiation year. Their contract is due up June 30th. I don't know what the town, the Board of Selectmen are going to enter into an agreement with them. The only thing I've done is budget a step increase for them as part of the last contract.
So there is no cost of living increase?
Unless you're at step 10. If you're at step 10, you're maxed out. So then we give you a COLA.
So, yes. So for the steps, you've extended the previous contract because you don't have the new information.
Yes.
And then what did you assume for the COLA in
for
here?
COLA, I believe the Selectmen voted 1.7%.
Okay.
I believe that's what they voted.
So
I have to find it.
The grade P4, is that part of the negotiated Thank contract you. Or is that something separate? That's yours.
No, I'm not part of the collective bargaining okay. agreement. Nope.
And so
nope.
you're the only one on a COLA then, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Does that fit into does your position fit into the salary schedule for the town someplace?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, there's a police wage scale for patrolmen, detective, sergeant, and chief. And when you go through it, mine fits right at the top of chief. Yes. Yep.
Now, are one of the names in at least our budget stale? Or is everything?
Which one?
Looking at the first officer name on my sheet, I thought. I didn't know if...
One of our guys just left for the town right next door to his hometown. That was Garrett Dana.
Okay.
So Garrett did leave. We are replacing him with Brent Griffin.
Okay.
And the salary is going to be roughly the same. Brent's going to come in at $2.50 less an hour. However, with the education incentive... Mm-hmm. He gets $100 a week for a bachelor's degree. So it comes out to $5,200 a year for that. So if you divide it out, you're really at the same exact level. So I kind of just left it alone.
Okay.
I didn't have him reprint everything and anything under the sun for a changeover, which is pretty much within $1,000 of each other.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I don't know that I saw either of those names on our list. And again, maybe this is just stale.
They aren't. And there is nothing in the school resource officer.
So they're going to not be happy with me for saying this. I used to give you a, and most of you are well aware, a 40 to 50 page budget. I would give you a full summary.
Yep.
I would give you everything and anything under the sun, including photographs of what the police department did, the arrest volume, everything.
Mm-hmm.
The town, the Board of Selectmen wanted to simplify it and pretty much just streamline the process. So I submitted all my numbers to them. These numbers have been modified multiple times.
Okay.
Without me in the room.
Okay.
Oh, really?
So you, sometimes you're asking me questions and
so you may not have a resource officer then.
The resource officer, I can tell you that we implemented the position, as most are aware, effective like August 18th, and I've been scraping in money. Deerfield Academy donated $30,000 towards the revolving fund, and that's been working phenomenal. But what I found is that replacing that position permanently, we really need to backfill Brian Ravish's position full-time, because we can't keep running our part-time guys that much. We're running into a liability situation with how much we can work them. If we regularly schedule people more than 19 and a half hours a week, we get into a benefited position, at which point, whether they like it or not, they can come back and ask for benefits. And I refuse to do that. I don't want to put the town in liability. Mm-hmm. So I'm very, very cautious of how many hours we work people a month and regularly scheduling them in accordance with the law. So what I did was, when I take the base salary and I factor in benefits and I take that total number, it comes out to $60,000 to $65,000 a year. I knew Deerfield Academy has told me that they will contribute $30,000 a year. I knew I needed to make up $35,000 to $40,000 to fund that position for the 60 or 65.
Mm-hmm.
So what I effectively did is I put in for the town for the $41,000 for the actual payroll.
Mm-hmm.
And then the benefits would come out of that revolving account, out of that $30,000, and there's my match of money. The selectmen are entertaining back and forth discussion with the school, with Marty Barrett, with possibly funding some of it from Frontier, some of it from Deerfield Elementary, and then figuring out if we can do a reduced amount.
Mm-hmm.
The other option that's there is if we do get a medical marijuana dispensary in town, as part of the special permitting fees and the host agreement, we asked for a full-time school resource officer.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know if that's gonna happen. They may be issued a license June 30th, and we may not even have to use the money because we may get money into that account. So, one of the issues I had to address with a couple people in town was last year, annual town meeting, we passed a revolving account. Under 53E and a half, you have to, on an annual basis, reauthorize all revolving accounts again. Well, we added one for the school resource officer, but we capped it at $75,000. With that said, several people in the audience thought that we actually funded the position. People came up to me after annual town meeting and congratulated me and said, you got your school resource officer. And I said, no, I didn't. No, this is just a step in the right direction. What do you mean? They didn't realize the funding wasn't actually in there.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to make that happen, I've been taking progressive steps to see what we can do for alternative funding, including the medical marijuana dispensary or possibly partnering with the schools, retouching base with Bemet and Eagle Brook as well, and kind of figuring out where we're at. To me, it's a critical position. Deerfield is not unique, but you got to admit, we are a little odd. We have 2,400 kids. When you take Bement, Deerfield Academy, Eagle Brook, Frontier Regional, Deerfield Elementary, which is a high choice with school popularity, we have 2,400 kids. And I want their future to be set up to succeed. And I know when they look at police as a valuable resource, that they know they can come to us at any point in time with a problem, that's a home run. It's a minimal cost, and it's a home run. I want all these kids to understand that we are here to help them forever. And to me, there's no better tone set than a cop walking through the elementary school, playing with the kids, 1-2 days a week, then going to the high school, dealing with some issues up there and talking to the kids up there. They have a government class up there that we are starting a student police academy with. Brian started it last fall. Kids absolutely loved it. He brought in a canine for a demonstration. He brought somebody in from crime scene services, from state police. He brought in like six or eight different guest speakers. Jeremy Cotton came in from the state police bomb squad, and the kids are ecstatic. We just started our second one this new semester. So we're running another class now. The kids just came in last week for a tour at the police station. The program's working phenomenal. I want to see it continue, but obviously I'm a realist. There's only so much money, and that's why I'm exploring other avenues.
I think you're right, John. We go up to the Franklin County Trade School a lot, and there's a full-time officer. Maybe there is in every school, I don't know, but there's one up there, and I can't help but notice the camaraderie between him and all the kids. It's just, it's really, really good to see that.
I work in an environment with a school resource officer, and it's night and day, whether you have one or not have one. And the benefits definitely outweigh the expense. There's no question about it. With everything you said, you're right on target. I back you up 100% with those comments, because that really does take place. It's amazing how those kids interact with that officer and feel safe. That's another person they can talk to one-on-one about issues that they would not share with anybody else.
Right.
So I think it pays huge dividends to have a person like that on board.
You know what really set the tone with me? When I first came back as chief of police, I came from Sturbridge. And I'm not blowing my own whistle by any means. You go to Sturbridge and talk to any of the principals there. When I walked into a school there, kids would come up to me and they would talk to me. Yeah. They saw me all the time. I was not the school resource officer. The businesses in town, same way. Unfortunately, now I'm buried in paperwork and administrative reviews, and I'm more threatened by a paper cut than I am a motor vehicle stop. So, but when I came back to my hometown and I walked in the elementary school and kids are like, "What is he doing here?" I went, "Time out. We have a problem." We have a problem. When I walked into Burgess Elementary School in Sturbridge, people like, "Hey, Officer John, hey, Officer John, come back here." And I'm like, this is Deerfield. They should not be looking at police like, why are you here? I want to set them up to succeed. And I want them to know that we're there for them. So that's what really drove it home with me. And that's when I started visiting the schools. And now it's just natural. I mean, my kids are in the school, so they see me all the time. Yeah.
I agree.
And that's the, when you walk in now, they don't anticipate you're there because it's a problem. They just, he's here, he's always here, so, or the resource officer's always here.
Yeah, one of the issues that we've seen over the last few years is technology's coming back to hurt us with parents and the kids. So with the elementary school being proactive and Marty Barrett being proactive, we decided that we'd go in and do an education for 4th, 5th, and 6th grade on cyberbullying, your digital footprint these days, how you can be tracked with future employment. And I went in and I started talking about host computers and slave computers and viruses versus Trojan adware, malware, etc. And the kids were absolutely amazed. Some of them I was talking over their heads, some of them I was wowing. And I think they received it very well, that you have to be extremely careful. The internet can be an incredible partner, or it can come back to burn you. And you want to be very careful how you utilize that skill. So
how do I say this? We should be supportive of the select board looking to pull money out of other places. So that's still up in the air how it's going to get budgeted.
Yeah, I'm not sure they're against the position, Bill.
Right,
that's a great position. I just don't know what funding mechanism they're working on or what the current plan is. Me, for security, I like to just put it in the town budget. Know it's there, and then if we get money, reimburse it in free cash. Okay. Stick it in the general fund and reimburse it. That way I know definitively it's there. But then I'm also a realist. There's only so much money. And when it comes right down to it, till April 1st and we're juggling numbers, a new position? Or are we cutting a staff over here? Or do we have to reduce this capital? I've seen it year after year after year. I am a realist.
The person in this position, do they just cover the two schools here in town, or do they cover
all five? They go to Eagle Brook maybe once a week. They go to Bement about once a month. We do lockdown drills with Bement. We partner with Ken Cuttaback very closely. Yep. Any issues there, Ken calls me right away. Deerfield Academy, we're at all the time for a visible presence. They donated $30,000. So,
well, yeah.
You know, we want that presence up there. But where you really see the core of it is Deerfield Academy, Frontier, and Deerfield Elementary. And when I really like Brian over there is when school is either going into session, all the kids are being dropped off, mm-hmm. because you get that parent interaction, or the pickup time, because we know there's traffic problems, we know there's safety problems. If we went to build an elementary school these days on one side of the road and a parking lot on the other side of the road, I'd have a conniption. I would not allow that under any new standards, but we did it. It is what it is. So now we deal with the problem that comes along with it. So I like to see them over there during that time period and then walk through periodically through the days. Now, we have other issues there. We have bullying incidents where we deal with the school and make it very well known, I am not out to criminally charge kids. Kids are kids. Kids have bad judgment. They error in times, and they live and learn. If we see they're learning and the school's addressing it, we never step in a criminal environment. We are there to foster their needs and help them. When a kid is out of control and the school says, time out, we've done everything we can, now we entertain the courts. Now we entertain juvenile probation and say, okay, what can we do for this kid? Because we need to step it up. This kid is headed down the wrong path. So that's kind of where my thoughts are with that. And I'm hoping there's money there to do it, but you guys see the full picture. I don't. I just put in my request. And
We sometimes see the full picture. When they don't put any money in, it's tough to see the picture.
Like I said, they may be looking at alternative funding. I don't know. I've not got any definitive word that it was removed.
What have you got in there for the Quinn bill? Out of curiosity, what did you put in?
Last I knew, it was in the mid to high 50s for the educational incentive.
No,
Where is it?
It's
looks like 56,326. Does that agree with yours?
No.
We have 49.
Oh, I'm sorry, 49.9. Yeah, okay. I looked at 2016.
How does that work?
There's three different.
I realize the Quinn bill no longer exists, but yeah.
It technically does, but it doesn't. Yeah. We get into legal terminology. There's three different levels of educational incentive with the town of Deerfield for the police department. There is old Quinn bill eligible employees that are still paid at 100% of the value. For people out there that don't know, that means if you have an associate's degree, your base pay comes up 10%. If you have a bachelor's degree, your base pay comes up 20%. If you have a master's, it comes up 25%. The law was amended in 1977. It used to be 30% for a master's degree. So it's 10, 20, and 25%. Those are incorporated into people's base pay. And when we entered into contract negotiations, we came up with two different levels of the Quinn bill in the contract as well. People that were previously Quinn bill eligible, if we hire them, if I swiped the cop from Sunderland, mm-hmm. and I hired him full time, and he or she was Quinn bill eligible, we would continue to pay the town's 50% portion only, not the 100%. So any new hire would be 50%. Now, any new hire that was totally not Quinn bill eligible, if they had a bachelor's or master's degree, they get $100 a week in accordance with the contract, and it's subject to chief of police approval. I can go higher than the $100 a week. If I get somebody with a master's degree in psychology and say, oh God, this guy's a phenomenal cop, you know, will the selectman agree to $150 a week to the educational incentive? The contract is worded that I can do that. So there's three different levels of the educational incentive within the police department. And it really needs to be ironed out and mirrored into one. Yeah.
But that's part of the contract.
That is part of the contract.
Okay.
Yep. Did I confuse you?
No. Now I understand why the 49.9, because I was going to say, geez, you know, 10%. I'm going to guess that most people are, you know, 99% of your police officers are going to have an associate's degree. And 10% was my, and I'm looking at it and saying, that's it's not a whole lot more than 10% in there.
Yeah.
Or it isn't even 10%.
Yeah, I have two cops that have no degrees, and I have one with a master's, two with bachelor's, two with associates. So I have every end of the spectrum. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Good questions.
Is there anything on the on these lower sections within the payroll budget, you know, that a lot of the other ones didn't seem to change from last year other than Quinnville? Yeah, I know you keep pretty good track of it in terms of what ends up getting spent and how are those kind of coming in.
Most of our numbers are pretty close. If you go back and audit the past 3 to 4 years that I've been chief of police, you'll note that I annually turn in about $16,000 to $30,000.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very frugal in what I spend. I watch the numbers meticulously. Even my administrative assistant looks at me and rolls her eyes. So with that said, the numbers right now, we're in the positive about 1.4%. And the only reason it's not higher is because I implemented the school resource officer, mm-hmm. and I thought it was a true value to the town. And so we have right now, if you were to do an exact percentage to date for payroll, about a $9,000 surplus. So most people say that's great, and it is good. But in policing, I'm a realist. Your budget can fluctuate. You can lose an employee, you can hire an employee, you can lose somebody on extensive sick leave, Family Medical Leave Act, et cetera, et cetera. Overtime for a major case, you can burn through $6,000 or $9,000 within 2 or 3 months, and I'm back at you guys at town meeting going, yeah, I'm not gonna turn anything in.
Yeah.
So right now we're hovering pretty good. All those numbers specifically, Dylan, are pretty accurate. They're off by maybe 2% in some areas.
Okay.
But 2% variable, that's not bad.
Okay.
Yep.
And then real quickly, and without going into names, just can you articulate ranks and full-time, part-time of kind of your staff right now and any changes? And I understand that the resource officer is kind of in flex a bit right now. So obviously yourself, two full-time sergeants.
Yep, then I got two sergeants, Mike Krzyzewski and Harry Ruddick.
Yeah.
Yeah, Harry's been with us about 28 years. Michael's been with us about 16.
Okay. And then three full-time officers?
Below that, I have five full-time people.
Okay. Sorry, I thought it was five total. I guess it's five officers.
Nope, there's,
gotcha.
There's eight full-time people total. If you add in a full-time administrative assistant, we are in a staffing of 9 full-time people.
Okay, so everyone on here, those are all your full-times
yes,
listed.
Those are all
okay,
full-time
gotcha.
Cops.
Yep.
Yep, and then we have 15 part-time police officers.
Okay. All right. So I know you said some of the names may not be right, but the designations are accurate.
Let me look at yours. Yep.
The your part-time people. I don't think they're in here.
Are they? Do you see them?
No.
The part-time people are not listed by names. However, if you go down below to the vacation and holiday pay and the training account, shift coverage up a couple lines, all that is part-time staffing. Anybody that knows me well knows if you say the word overtime in front of me, I'll give you a dirty look. I utilize part-time people to the best of our ability. I don't put out overtime unless I have to because it's not cost-effective. So if you look through those line items, again, under shift coverage, you'll see $36,750.
Mm-hmm.
If you then scroll down, you'll come to vacation pay with everybody's vacation to backfill that on the agency. And that includes additional shift coverage. Then there's holiday pay. And if a police officer takes off the holiday and we don't pay them that additional day, mm-hmm. but we backfill it with a part-time guy, that's the account it comes out.
Okay.
So, yep.
So you say those three, shift coverage, vacation pay, holiday pay, or was there also the training, was one of the training ones in there
the
too?
The special training account.
Okay.
I gather you spend a lot of time on budget work.
Yeah, I used to spend more for you guys. Like I said, I used to go through and audit cases and really give you a true grasp of what the police department does. It's very difficult to do. We responded to two motor vehicle accidents today. Officer Suklosky's wrapping up a $28,000 larceny from an elderly female up in Old Deerfield from a caretaker. You know, that'll be probably going to grand jury. I don't want to get into too many cases, but we're small, but yet we're always busy. Being that host community, that hub community, the five schools or all the businesses, the industrial parks, it's always something.
If we were to meet sometime during the calendar year with you just to talk about the department and get some more detail from you, what would be a time of the year that that would work for you?
Anytime. I'm always around. Seriously. I mean, my phone rings 24 hours a day. I'm always flown around. Everybody knows I live in town. I'm a hometown boy. Rachel and I go on vacation with the kids once, twice a year. Generally, when it's negative 30, I try and jump a plane to the Caribbean. Other than that, I'm around all year. So summer doesn't bother me. Winter, fall. Anytime you guys want to meet, send me an email. And I'll come in. You could throw whatever ideas or questions by me. If you can figure out a more cost-effective approach, I'm all about it.
No, I'm thinking that the effort at simplifying this process leaves us kind of uninformed to some extent. Because you did a wonderful job before of giving us a snapshot of the department, and you know, I'd like to see that.
Sometime. So, what have you got for a total? What have you got for a total for the payroll?
$744,638. That's with a school resource officer budgeted in at patrolman step one, $40,152.
Is it 48 or 38?
38.
Okay.
Yep, 744,638.
Oh, 638.
And with the school resource officer, it's a 6.2% increase. Without the school resource officer, I think it was under a 1% increase.
0.85.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Well, I think on this one, we're probably going to need to get some more clarity from Doug and such on resource officer and some of these numbers. But does anyone else have any questions about the payroll section here?
Nope.
And then the department benefits, I think, unless you have something to add, is really more of an apportioning of some numbers from Barbara's office to the department.
I was going
to
say, did you look at the benefits section?
No. Nope. This is the first time I've ever seen it.
Us as well. So all right. All on the same page.
Well, I think this is a new part of the process that we asked for, is to start.
Correct.
Start pulling those benefits back so the departments are aware of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that 37% add-on, if you will.
Yeah. Yep. Franklin County retirement in of itself is 18.91%.
Mm-hmm.
And then group insurance, depending on how many family medical plans you have versus singles, obviously adds up quick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yep.
And I think there's still some details to iron out whether, you know, your department is big enough where you could actually try to apportion specific costs and no one's going to know what anybody's plan is because there's enough people.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, if you just take the total for the town amount, average per person, however many people you have, it's that number times whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that there's still some details that people are trying to sort out on that front. But
even that would work well just to average it out. We'd have some kind of value anyway, and managers would as well.
Yeah, I don't mind either way. The only reason I like the full town account with benefits, especially general insurance, is because you have a fluctuation throughout the year with school employees, with the police department, with highway employees. Yeah. Somebody will jump on a family medical plan that has a kid or now gets married, mm-hmm. or you'll lose an employee, you hire a new employee. It allows so much more flexibility versus mid-year, you're just dealing with the police department in a personnel change. Mm-hmm. Now it affects multiple different line items.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Dramatically.
Yeah.
Yep. So I totally agree for a tracking purpose and true accountability to the people. This is phenomenal. But when it comes to an actual usable account with some flexibility, I like that single account.
Yep.
Because it gives Barbara that flexibility and availability
exactly.
to do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Because at the end of the day, that's what it really is.
Absolutely.
You know, regardless.
Yep.
Yeah.
What did I miss?
Lease expenses.
Expenses, the last one.
Yeah, anything in payroll, though? Any more questions?
I mean, you know, if we have some follow-up after getting some more information on how the select board is entertaining trying to fund that resource officer or some of these other moving parts, we can reach back out to you.
Absolutely.
But I think that's a lot of it.
Yeah, like I said, the money may not be there. You guys see the full budget package. I don't.
Yeah.
So there may be a method to the madness. We are looking at other funding mechanisms. Maybe that's why they pulled it off.
Well, and I can't speak for everyone here, but I think one thing that I've looked at the last couple of years on the budgets is I think we've been underinvesting in, some of the capital components. So when I look at, and I'm not picking on anything here, but cruiser versus some of the expense line items, I'm going to be more focused on getting things like cruisers through. Those are longer term investments mm-hmm. for the town that it's so easy to skimp on mm-hmm. and force people to kind of cut corners and work short. And that's where, we really want to try to prioritize that.
In the long run, you pay mm-hmm. when you do that.
Yep.
So with that, I guess, we're going to pass on voting on payroll or benefits till we get some answers and numbers on that. On the benefits, I'd like to see what they've put into other. The only thing I would guess would be potentially OPEB, but I didn't think we were doing anything with that.
No, we're not.
So
yet.
Maybe
no.
It's...
I know there's life insurance, but that's only $55 a year per employee.
I thought that was high for just that, but we'll figure that out and come back. So I guess on to expense then.
So expenses we'll run through very quickly. You'll see a couple different numbers here. Clothing regular, I don't know what yours says. I put in for $7,200. The reason I did is because by contract, my full-time guys are given $800 a year as a clothing allowance. If I add in the additional school resource officer, I'm going from position number 8 to number 9. That's why you see an $800 increase there mm-hmm. from $6,400 to $7,200. Going down one, special police officers. We have 15 part-time police officers that do a phenomenal job. And the last time we increased their clothing allowance was 1997. We gave them $200 a year. They have no contract. Mm-hmm. They're not union. They're not anything. I stuck them in for $250. Okay. So the first time in many, many years. So that's why you see it from $3,000 to $3,750. And again, if we don't have the money, we don't have the money. It's okay. But I'm not doing my job unless I'm peeking here or there and trying. Gasoline, $29,000. We all know that gas is coming down, and hopefully it continues to drop, but this is always a difficult situation for me because none of us can predict where it's going.
Approximately how many gallons are you estimating?
A high month for us is about $2,200 right now at the current rates, so about $26,000. That's a high month for the year, so $26,000 for the year. The problem I have is if it fluctuates even 10 or 20%, instantly that 26,000 becomes 29,000, or if it drops down a little bit, it gives me a little more wiggle room in the budget to either turn back money mm-hmm. or the $38,000 that I used to get in community policing money that we've no longer get in the last 4 to 5 years. It allows me to make up some of that. My radar units, my handheld radar units, my guys brought to my attention last week, are 16 years old. They said, this one's broken. It broke last week. And this one over here is really on its way out too. And it was just dropped on me. I thought we did a full equipment evaluation and we looked at it. When I first became chief, we did a long-term capital plan. I sold the capital improvement committee on it. We did a full audit of the agency of anything and everything. Somehow those two units skipped past us. And what happens is if I do have a little leftover money in gasoline, I then can go ahead and purchase those items without coming back to capital or reserve fund request or going through the whole budget process. So again, it allows me the flexibility to move that. So that's gasoline for the year. Tires, we've been averaging, hit or miss. I think we're at like $4,200 this year. We overspent it, but that's because we put, I think, 3 new sets of snow tires on those utilities, and it is what it is. Some years are high and some years are low. Hopefully those winter tires will last us the next 3 seasons on those utilities.
Excuse me, John, going back to gasoline.
Yeah.
Where do you buy that, at the local gas?
We get it at any of the local gas stores, and we have what's called a Wright Express account. It's used by the federal government. It's used by the state police, Mass DOT. and it's a corporate town account that they immediately take all the taxes right off of. Okay. So if you go to the pump and you're paying $1.71, we're probably paying more like $1.40. And okay. It instantly comes off the bill. There's no negotiating. There's no anything.
Good.
You can take it anywhere in the country. Every officer is assigned a unique PIN number, and there's a card in every single cruiser. I send a guy to Boston to a conference or to Marlboro for a training, and they need to mm-hmm. fill up out there. There's zero issue.
Okay.
Here's the card. Here's the PIN number. Here's the time. Here's the gas mileage. The taxes subtracted off of it right through.
I was totally unaware of that, but that's
so you get a bill?
Every month we get a bill from Wright Express.
Okay.
Yep.
Basically a credit card,
exactly.
So to speak. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can you use that down at the highway garage too?
No, it doesn't work at the highway garage. Yep. That's always a very big quandary. Do you put gas out to bid for the year? Do you go off a town account? It fluctuates so much.
Yeah.
A lot of towns got burned. I can tell you a town that is close to us and works very well with us did the annual bid last year, and they locked in May for the year at $3.51 a gallon. And they called me on it 2 months ago, and I had to explain to them, okay, go back to the bid documents. How many gallons did you estimate you would use? So in full faith agreement, you've complied with that bid. Now, on top of that, I want you to get a Wright Express account for the town. And once you've met those gallons with that bid, do not spend a dime over. Start taking it off the Wright Express account at the $1.40 per gallon, and hopefully it will save you money in the long run. So you don't want to put the town in a liability situation. That complies with the bid. It makes everybody happy, and that town saves some money out of it. Let's see. No changes. Overall, I think the last question that we usually have is new equipment. New equipment I've increased over the years to account for either new firearms, new portable breathalyzers, new throw bags in the cruisers, first aid equipment. There's so many things in the police department that we used to replace out of that grant account, that $38,000 of community policing where we initially bought these defibrillators, that we no longer get. And that account was so flexible with us to go ahead and put in for that stuff every year. And really, our new equipment was getting old. Our portable radios now are 9 or 10 years old. They're commercial duty radios. They're not public safety radios. They're carpenter, contractor, plumber radios that we've been using in a public safety format. They're not waterproof. They're not heavy duty. If you're in a fight, they're more likely to break. But it is what it is. New radios are $2,300 a piece. So what I've been doing is every year off the emergency management grant for MEMA, I've been buying one portable radio off of it for the $2,300. Then I'm required to match that $2,300 with $2,300 of town funds. I then buy a portable radio for the police department off of town funds to comply with the grant. So now every single year I'm buying two portable radios. So over a 5-year time period, we're replacing those radios and we're getting new, better technology for the police officers, but we're doing it in a cost-effective mm-hmm. overtime format.
How many total do you have to buy, and how far along are you on that?
I have four now. I just ordered two. The grant just got released, so that's six. And I think in total we have 14.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
So four more years and you'll be there.
Yeah, it's like anything mm-hmm. else. The more you build an agency, the capacity and capabilities of it, the more equipment you need. And it's a delicate balance. You don't want too many cruisers. You don't want too much equipment. You don't want too much payroll budget to the point where the townspeople start to red flag it and say, John Pachorik's either building a empire, or, you know, that kid's overspending, or, you know, the comments, they just flow and flow and flow. So, but you have to build an agency that's able to respond to a major incident. And if you think about any major incident, whether it's a fatal accident or a train derailment or a chemical spill or a fertilizer plant that a fire starts at, it is not hard to utilize 8 to 15 police officers to evacuate houses, to cordon off an area, to start blocking off roads, maintaining a perimeter, never mind starting an investigation and dealing with people that are injured. So when we look at, you know, 10 or 14 portable radios, that's not even a lot. It really isn't. You look at our asphalt plant in town or the fertilizer plant or a derailment, we have the possibilities of a major incident here. And we're more prone because of 91, 5 and 10, the railroad tracks, 116, all the way through. So little by little, I'm trying to enhance what the police department can do, but consciously watching that I'm not overstepping and the townspeople are looking at me going, what are you doing? No, that's not what we want here. I don't want that reputation.
Is there a state certification for emergency first responders, not EMTs? I mean, our police officers act as first
police officers are required under law to be first responders, which is a 40-hour training course.
Okay.
Yeah, the Red Cross calls it responding to emergencies. The Municipal Police Training Committee actually has a course, and they have certified instructors. Dave Zamoyski's been phenomenal. He does our agency every 3 years. He does CPR every 2 years with us. He comes in, he does one half of our department one night and one half in another night. So that's how we maintain it. The new kids get it at the academy.
Okay.
Yep.
With regard to guns, there's handguns and rifles and ammunition. Is there some kind of a upgrade that you do on a regular basis as far as technology, and or are those long-term capital items? Of course, ammunition is something else, but I mean.
Yeah, the last time our firearms were changed out was 2000. So we're approaching year 16. And last April, the FBI released a brand new study. And what it said was that police departments are migrating to too high of a caliber of a firearm, that shot placement, if you're involved in a shooting, is much more important than the caliber, because a 9mm penetrates nearly the same as a 45 caliber. However, it doesn't do the internal damage because that round doesn't spread as much as a 45. We know that. We know it's a faster round, but it doesn't have as much foot pressure behind it. So there's variables to it. But the FBI's conclusion in that 18-page study was you're better off going back to a 9mm and actually touching the target versus the bystanders around it or missing because you're trying to hit somebody with a 45 in the recoil.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I told my guys, explore our options and figure out what we can do. Chad Risley, most people know him. Chad's a phenomenal kid. He went out and he found a dealer that will do a one-for-one gun swap with us. We trade in our old 6 hours because they remanufacture it, they sell them overseas, and they make money. It's an expensive gun. Transitioning to the Glock 17. I have three firearms instructors. One is Joey Mitch, full-time at UMass Amherst. I have two that are actually full-time police officers in Deerfield. Those three people test-fired six different guns, and they brought our department members up. They invited them up. Come test-fire the guns and figure out what you like, what you don't like, and give us your input. So they T&E'd the guns last summer, and they decided that they would go over to a Glock 17.
That's a 9mm?
That's a 9mm Glock, yep. And anybody that, again, knows me well knows I'm not a big gun guy. They don't scare me. I don't dislike them, but I don't like them. I don't take them, give them. I don't care. I'm a firm believer in the Second Amendment, but I don't have any. I have one personal gun. It's in my office because my 8-year-old son is infatuated with them. So they don't go in my house.
Are all.
So with that said, we entered into an agreement with the Board of Selectmen's approval and the procurement authority in town to swap those guns out. We've purchased new holsters. Those guns arrived last Thursday. We are now in the process of setting up a training at the indoor facility up in East Deerfield with Mark St. Amand, the president up there, and migrating our whole agency over to a brand new gun. The 9mm is a lot more cost-effective round. Anybody knows that's well-versed in firearms, it's 40% less per round And so your training costs are automatically down. The gun itself comes with three different size grips on it. If you have a larger frame hand, you can add grip size to it. If you have a smaller frame hand, you can go with the smallest grip to naturally feel good with that firearm. Good. We didn't have that availability with the Sig Sauer. So there's several positive moves here. Is it costing us money? Yeah, it is. It's costing me $2,500 out of my expense account to buy new holsters and buy new magazine pouches for everybody on the agency. But I'm able to do that because gas prices are low. And that savings is there. So I'm able to do it. Is it going to cost me money to ultimately train people? Yeah, I'm going to have to pay them for a day or two to stand out at the range. We're going to have to do two or three different days. That's perfectly fine. In the long run, it's what's best for the town and our agency. We're migrating to a new firearm. It's less of a training cost, less investment in rounds, and overall, a better situation. Michigan State Police just transitioned their whole agency to the Glock 17. So as soon as this study came out last year, several departments started migrating over to the 9mm. And again, we were no different. So that's kind of where we're at with firearms.
So was it 20 years ago that we were using 9mm, or were they 357s that everybody...
We had 9mm, yes. Yeah, we had the P228, which is a Sig Sauer. It's one of my favorite guns. Yep. And then we transitioned up to the 45. Yep. And we bought that with drug forfeiture money. Yep.
Well, that kind of answers what I was after. I'm not a gun person either, but I was just curious whether we're up to speed, whether we're staying aware of where things are at. And it sounds like you're right on target there.
Yeah, everything I do, like I said, is methodical. It's slow, well thought out. When I got here, we had four different patrol rifles in the cruiser. One was a 9mm, one was a 40 caliber, two were .223 rounds. And that's unacceptable. You need one standardized gun. If you jump from car to car to car, from a detail to court, and you respond to an incident, etc., you want one standardized gun in those cars. That was accomplished 2 years ago when gas first dropped.
So what are you using in?
They're all .223s.
Okay.
Yep, they're all Colts, and they're all .223s. Yep, the problem I have now, and people, are going to think I'm crazy, and I will explain it to you in depth, is in the next 6 months, I'm going to take all six of those long guns, and I'm going to have silencers put on them. Mm-hmm. And my firearms guys recommended it, and I looked at them cross-eyed and said, what? Silencer? What? And they said, think about it. If you respond to a workplace violence incident, if you go to UPS or the old Hardig Pelican, or you go to Frontier, doesn't matter. You discharge one round out of that gun, you can't hear a damn thing after. You could have two shooters behind you, you would not even know they're behind you. That gun is so loud, the percussion off the walls. Never mind you're going to have an officer out on disability for a hearing loss at 72%. You're taking that cop out of the gunfight. They can't hear a damn thing. And I sat there and listened to him, and I went, God, that makes sense.
Yeah.
We do have to do that.
It would seem that it would also make sense, and that if that's the case and you hear a gunshot, you know it's not coming from one of your officers.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, that crossed my mind, Skip, too, that you can distinguish.
Yeah. I almost fell out of my chair when they started talking about silencers. I'm like, what? And then they started to explain to me, and I went, you know what? My God,
it makes
you're
a lot
absolutely
of sense.
Right.
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It does make a lot of sense. When you first brought it up, I think to myself, are we going a little overboard here? But
I thought the same thing.
When you, with your explanation, it definitely makes a whole lot of sense.
Yep.
No question.
Yeah, they're fighting with me in my office. Boss, as soon as we throw out that first round, you're done. You're out of the gunfight. Mm-hmm. You can't hear a damn thing.
Yep.
And never mind, you're going to have cops on disability. I'm like, yeah, you just sold me.
A couple of my friends have done a lot of shooting, and they both have hearing loss, and it's a real problem. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't inside a building.
Yep. And just to be clear, we don't have any fully automatic weapons. We are not a militarized organization. We don't have any SWAT team. There's nothing hidden about the Deerfield Police Department, just to be clear and upfront with you. Yep.
Yeah, some of these departments and towns went over the top. They're nuts.
Yeah, no, we don't have any military equipment. Yep. We participated prior to my administration in the 1033 program, the military acquisition, and I know Chief Waz was extremely selective in what he got. But we never got vehicles, we never got guns, we never got anything that would red flag. So, yeah, he got a couple pieces, but nothing of substance.
Good.
Any other
Thank you.
Questions? One thing that may be expense or maybe another section, you talked about the detail fees that come in at the beginning. We're talking about something else. Now, where do those flow through and how do those come back?
All the revenue that flows into the police department by state law has to go into the general fund.
Okay.
Other than a revolving fund set up for the police department, everything has to go to the general fund. Mm-hmm. So all detail fees, like motor vehicle law fines, if we go out and write traffic tickets, the state says, absolutely, you cannot take those back into your police department, because what's it encourage cops to do?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Go out and hammer traffic, and that's not what we want. We want it as an enforcement mechanism when we need it, mm-hmm. not just as a revenue generator.
But your detail goes in, and that's a
general fund.
The detail, too?
I'm sorry, detail, the revolving fund?
Yeah, that goes into
the revolving fund. But the administration fee and that cruiser fee go into the general fund of the town. Yes. What happens is we have a revolving fund for the police department with regards to traffic details, outside details, basketball games, whatever it may be. Mm-hmm. We funded that account up front. We pay people out of that account. And then a week, two, three, 4 weeks after we bill it and we get a check-in, that money goes back into the account. When we do that deposit with Barbara and Brenda, we actually separate out on the sheet mm-hmm. this percent for admin fees, this percent for cruiser fees, and this amount goes back into the detail account. Brenda actually requires that we give her the detail slips so she can see Western Mass Electric Company, and she can see they were billed at $347.50 and they paid $347.50 and $40 went towards a cruiser and here's the admin fee and everything's checks and balances. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And so the people that you're paying that are doing the detail, if you go back to the payroll sheet, I guess which bucket would payroll
nothing to do with this.
It doesn't show up at all. It's all extra and separate from.
It's an original fully funded account that we voted in town meeting in 2011 or 12.
Okay.
It's in its own separate account. It's nothing in these budget sheets.
Yep.
Yep. And every 3 months, my administrative assistant, Deb, and Brenda sit down together and they reconcile that account penny for penny.
Okay.
And it was just done. I know December 31st, they've already balanced it out and it's spot on.
Yep. Okay. So a given officer who, let's say, works his full time, does some detail, no overtime, he'd have his salary as per this, and then also would be getting some detail income from that as well?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. Ultimately, when we do payroll, you would see their base pay at 80 hours. You would see their shift differential by the actual hours they work. So, you know, if they worked four midnights and then I had them on a week of days for training, they get four midnight shift of the differential, the $1.50 an hour, and then any overtime, any holiday pay, all the way down bottom on payroll is the detail sheet, and it's okay. All the detail numbers. Yep.
And then I guess back to the expense then, I see, obviously it was cut decently last year, so you know we appreciate you guys helping do that last year, which was a tough budget year. It may be tough again this year. We may be looking to try to keep it pretty flat this year. Mm-hmm. So I guess I just one thing to leave you with is if there are some of these line items, if we do need to come back mm-hmm. As we get some more of the bigger pieces together, the school numbers we don't have yet, which is obviously a big component, we may come back and look to ask for that. So, but I do, the two increases you made make a lot of sense to me. So I understand that we may be, you know, trying to take a little bit of reasonable room in some of the other areas, but we'll see where we end up.
Yeah, we've cut this pretty much as far as we could go, and you guys can peek back. This used to be at about $104,000 for police department expenses,
mm-hmm.
and then on top of that $104,000, we used to get that $38,000 community policing grant.
Mm-hmm.
So the fluff in my budget,
yep,
is gone.
Yeah, if there was fluff, we'd be asking now. I don't think there's fluff. Yeah. It's just if we, like, of your four things, we're not going to come back and ask. I would not come back and ask you to put off a cruiser versus come back and say, hey, is there a little bit we can do here? That's if we need to. That's kind of where I'm at.
Last year at hour 23 and a half, about a week before annual town meeting, I took $5,000 out of payroll.
Yeah.
To make the budget work.
Well, the biggest thing we're trying to do this year, because we don't have all the answers, is to do things sooner so there aren't our 23 and a half
hopefully
shifts. That's one of the goals that we're trying to set for this year, which won't be easy, but that's what we're trying.
Good.
So
good.
Would we like to vote this budget now? Obviously, if we have to re-pick it up, we can pick it up. Or do we want to put this off to do with the other two?
I would do all of them at once and see if we can get the right figures.
Okay, so the capital we pass, the other three we'll all handle together once we
get the four things. Makes sense.
Together, and if we have any other questions, you know, we'll come back.
Ask away or shoot me an email. Either or is fine.
Okay.
Yep, I mean, I can respond to an email in an hour and...
And I'd love to catch up with you separately on the revolving special revenues. I know we didn't connect today with our schedules, but as I said to you, I'm just going and trying to create a database of each of these things, purpose, point, contact, if there are any questions. You know, like I turned up one that we found out what it was today and people hadn't known. So just going through them, talking to everybody. I'll try to get you tomorrow or something.
Do you want to cover them quick? Mind if we're on camera? Doesn't bother me.
I don't either. It's more just because it's really a one. Like, I'm trying to collect all this from everybody, and then I'll present it back to the committee. Mm-hmm. So if you know off the top of your head, I'm happy to do it now.
That's fine. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Do you guys don't mind? Have that many. That's the only reason
that's
I
a
offer.
Thing. I don't. Yeah. Let me just grab my sheet here.
Shut the heat down in here.
Sorry, not as interesting for you all without any back story.
That's fine.
You guys were told Deerfield Academy came in and fixed all the heat for us.
No.
Yeah. Somebody told me.
The town hall was messed up for years. The police department was messed up.
I knew
years.
You had right. a problem. Yeah.
Kevin actually had several bids last year of $80,000 to $90,000 to gut the system, and I finally had enough. And I reached out to Keith Finan up at Deerfield Academy and said, "Listen, Gary, your head of HVAC is phenomenal. Would you send Gary Gripko down? Would he be willing to come down here and just look at it and say, yes, you need a full new system, or you need to do this, or throw some recommendations at me of really what we can do to fix this heat system?" I had cops walking into the upstairs of the police station with gated valves of turning them up and down. So you'd come back in with an arrest, it'd be 84 degrees in there. Then somebody go up there and turn it off, and the midnight shift would walk in, it'd be 66 in there. So there's a huge fluctuation. Gary Gripko came in, he looked at the police station, and he said, "Yeah, your control panel was installed by this company. They were just in my office. I use them at Deerfield Academy." I said, "Well, this is great." He goes, "No, it's not going to work. And this is why it's not going to work, because of this. These valves don't even respond to these controls. We need to pull this whole system out of here." So now I start having chest pain. "Yeah, how much does it cost to pull this full system out of here?" He goes, "Well, you know, let's figure this out." All right. I had to run to a meeting. He called me later on in the day and he said, "Listen, I'm going to have our electrician there tomorrow morning to figure out what we need to do and to give me a price so you know what you're looking at." So that's perfect, because I have no idea what to even tell somebody. Gary called me back an hour later again. It was now 10 minutes of 3 and said, "Word just came from the top of Deerfield Academy that we're paying for the whole thing." And he will be there tomorrow morning to look at it. So their electrical contractor came in. It was Friday morning at about 8:30. And I said, "All right, so, you know, what do you think, Drew? What are you looking at?" He goes, "Well, I'm going to pull out all your thermostats. I'm going to pull out the whole control system upstairs. We're going to change out the valves." Their plumber came down, and their HVAC, one of their HVAC techs from Deerfield Academy, worked with Drew all day. They gutted the system. By 4 o'clock, the police department was 100% fixed. They came back in the following Wednesday, and they ran two brand new wires out to the condensers, because we have two zones in the police department for air conditioning and heat. So they ran those. Those were up and running on Wednesday. I said, "By the way, have you guys peeked at the town hall yet? Because they're having issues as well." And that's all I had to say. They were over here for the next day and a half. They did the same thing. They gutted the system. And that I know of, the town hall employees have been ecstatic. So the system is functioning. We're not burning excessive fuel anymore, and it's steady heat.
Yeah.
Yep.
I know there's been so many, many complaints all the time I'm in here. I hear it from different people.
Those complaints should start to fall off.
Of course, this time of night, I'm sure it's cutting back.
This is pretty much the standard temperature in here.
Is it?
Yep. Yep.
It's just me.
I don't know the temperature, but this, yeah, I don't think this changes.
Yep.
I assume someplace at night it must go drop off, but
I think they have it set like midnight to 6 a.m. because there's a lot of meetings that go till 9 or 10 o'clock at night in here.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and a lot of times the selectmen won't even leave till 11:30.
Maybe they should turn it off at 9 o'clock.
I thought you were going to say the hot air's already on.
No, I'm not saying anymore. Just turn it off at 9 o'clock. Maybe
behaviors. Yep.
That's good, though. That's really...
We were here until 9:30 last week.
Yeah.
That's wonderful on their behalf to do that. That's a...
I got to tell you, and I know there's a lot of complaints of the townspeople about the nonprofits paying more in taxation. Anytime I've ever been to one of the private schools and I've asked for assistance, they have bent over backwards for me. So there's a true partnership there. Do I, along with many people, wish there was more money there? Sure, I do. But they do so many in-kind matches that we have to compile all that data and give it to town meeting as well, so the residents know. And that's why I mentioned it to you guys, because people don't realize that they come in and they do a lot of this stuff.
We ought to have some way of recognizing that, whether it's in the town report. But the problem is that if you start doing that, you're going to forget somebody and it's not going to get in there.
Yeah.
So you got, it's a double-edged sword, but you know, I think it is worth
exploring. What if we ask the Academy, would they be willing to, maybe they track it internally anyway?
They probably don't.
Deerfield Academy, when they mail us, at my request, a notice every April of all the things that they do for the town.
Oh, really?
Oh, they do.
And it goes to the selectmen, and it goes to Brenda, along with their annual donation. They do, the annual donation is twice a year. But one of those donation checks, the April one, that document accompanies it. And it lists out all the in-kind matches, you know, bus transportation for the elementary school or whatever else. Yep.
Sometimes just a sincere thank you off to the side counts a lot, too.
That counts more than anything. Yep. Oh, yeah. Yep.
A certain party could have informed us of this before.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What? What am
well,
I missing?
Well, it's the first we've heard of this, because we would have appreciated that a year or two ago, when we were ready to...
5 years ago.
Okay, well, yep. Real quick, just try to go through this, and we can all call it a night. Yeah. So the ones I see in some of these we've already talked about, Fund 230 is a school resource officer, as we spoke about, that had $30,000 put into it. 231, public health and safety, which is the... medical marijuana account we set up last year for potential funds. There's nothing.
They just opened their first facility yesterday, I think, in Salem.
In the state,
The company that was talking about coming out here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yep. I know we set up the revolving fund at $250,000 just to put money in and take it out. Yep. But I wanted the selectmen to leave it as broad as possible, so it was true public safety. Right. If we have a ton of mosquito problems that year. And Carolyn's all about that, we can utilize that funding. If we need to do defibrillators for all the town buildings, we can use that. I didn't want it specific for the police department. Mm-hmm. So, yep, that's a generalized account.
Okay. The next three, 4-4 is the community policing grant you spoke about. So this one still has a small amount of money in it using something. So is that kind of winding down still? I don't know. What are your...
That money was supposed to have been spent 9 years ago.
Okay. Yeah, there's not much in it. It's just...
Yeah, I think there's $3,000-$4,000 in it.
Yeah.
And it's my emergency side fund.
Okay.
That's all. I kind of just leave it floating there, and every year Brenda gives me an evil eye about it, and it is what it is.
Okay. Bulletproof vest grant. So that looks like something where you're buying stuff and getting reimbursed.
Yeah, what happens is, and it is a nightmare, I'll be honest with you.
We purchase
a vest, it's $700-$800 a piece, sometimes they're $900 a piece. We then have to put in for 50% state reimbursement. After we put in for the state reimbursement and we get a receipt, we then can put in for federal reimbursement. And it's a 50-50, and it takes 18 months to get that money back. So if you actually go through cherry sheets of the town, you'll see, well, the police department is deficiting spend that account by $4,000 with a bulletproof vest grant. Yeah. Then the next year, you'll find that it's $400 in the positive. We're like, but that's not even a vest. How does that even make sense? So yeah, it fluctuates. Yep.
Sure. The next one is the 4-6, the drug forfeiture grant.
Yep. Drug forfeiture funds by state law. We get funds on a regular basis for cases that the Deerfield police officers worked. Like last week, we got a $160 check. Sometimes we'll use that towards training. We'll use it towards firearms or anything that's relevant. There's actually a state law for drug forfeiture funds. I have to sign off on it, the DA's office, and then it goes to the Attorney General's office. So that's actually in compliance with state law, and it's very specific what the money can be used towards.
Okay. And I think there's just one more.
Property forfeiture?
No, that would have to go to the general fund.
Okay.
Yep. If it's actually drug related, it can go into that account.
Okay.
Anything else, yeah. Yep. Would have to go to the town general fund.
The last one I think I see is 892 is the firearm ID cards.
So what happens with the firearms licensing? Most are aware that we charge $100 for a license to carry renewal or an FID card renewal. They just change the fees, et cetera, et cetera. If you're over 70, there's no fee. Police officers, if it's your town, it's free. If they're a retired police officer, it's $25. All these different fees are collected. They are put into that fund, and then what happens is the Firearms Records Bureau bills us on a quarterly basis. So of $100, they take $75. Of course, it used to be 50-50. Well, actually, it used to be 100% town. We used to get the full money out of it.
Yeah.
Now they went to 50-50. Now it's 75-25. So the town actually keeps $25 of the $100 in that account. And every June 30th, when Brenda closes out accounts and puts them into free cash, that gets wiped clean. She comes to me and says, okay, so how much money can I take out of the account? How much do I need to leave in that account? You know, do we need to encumber money? And I need to wait for the final bill, you know, July 15th from Firearms Records Bureau, and Brenda and I work through it together.
Do you know why they need 75 instead of zero?
Because they can't.
The state looks
I think, are there any more that you think, because again, I'm going off a very
There's
brief.
The detail revolving account, and that's it.
That I did not.
And we'd actually have to ask Brenda what...
Oh, wait, I see one more here. Police donations fund, I see that, which is not what you're talking about.
Yeah, no.
There's that. Oh, here we go. Yep. Police detail revolving fund. Sorry, there it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the one where you're charging the people that you're doing the detail for, mm-hmm. and then apportioning it out to the guys doing the detail, the administrative, and the other...
In the cruiser,
cruiser fee.
Fee.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep.
Is that kind of it from things?
That's it.
Okay. And apologies, because I'm really just trying to go through and figure out some of these, you know, are unknown things that were set up a long time ago and people are trying to figure them out. But these ones for you are pretty straightforward.
Yeah, no reason to apologize. Yep. Brenda has no problems marching over to my office and saying, what is this? Yeah.
It's the ones where it's like, who's responsible? I can't ask a question because I don't even know what it is.
Yep. You mean like the surplus war bonds revolving fund?
Yeah. That one's pretty easy, though. There are some other ones in there. They just, you know.
Yeah.
But you remember, Skip, a couple years ago.
$18.92.
We used to have a ton of accounts that we were kind of using little by little to balance the budget every year, and those accounts have dwindled and dwindled.
They've gone.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so things are getting tighter and tighter.
Okay.
But...
Anybody else have anything?
No.
All right. Well, thank you for coming in. We'll be back with any questions, but I think we got a lot. I think a lot of the remaining stuff is stuff that really coming out of that office about where numbers are showing up.
Absolutely. So. Yeah. Just I think the only thing that we're off about is where the school resource officer is. Yep.
Yeah. That's a good one.
Yep.
All right. Any motions to adjourn? Or is there any other business you guys want to bring up? Otherwise, I'd plan to meet again next week, Tuesday, next to 6:30. Work again.
Yeah. That's good. Okay. That's good.
All right.
Yep.
Anyone care to make a motion?
I make a motion.
Second.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. More 9 o'clock. Thank you.